Tor Batulk, Ashnats Imbatul, Ashnatsra.
Oh, hello there. Don't mind me, I was just preparing the dice for the next chapter of Ironsworn. Hi, how are you? I'm Anderson, this is Kill 10 Rats, talks about Ironsworn. Kynan is going to be back next week. The chapter 2 will kick off then. I am currently in the middle of rearranging this room. Cameras aren't quite set up the way I want them to be. And so I will have 1 week without a regular scheduled Ironsworn video. And instead we're getting this one. What is this one about? It's more of a meta video, a little bit of a talk through of the chapter that we just closed and sort of my impressions and what it looked like from this side of the screen, plus a few things about the content of the channel that I've planned and I'm planning to set up. If that's of interest to you, thank you very much for continuing listening to me ramble, essentially. And if not, then just allow me to thank you very much for watching the main series, for subscribing, for commenting, for liking, for all of that YouTube stuff. There's been quite a bit of growth since I uploaded the first one of my videos, to a point where I didn't quite expect to get to this point that we are at now as quickly as I thought we might. So thanks for all the support, and let's head on into this video. Right, so I made a few notes, a lot of notes actually, to remind myself what I want to talk about, and so this doesn't turn into a completely unstructured ramble. First thing I'd like to touch upon is upcoming content on the channel, and also the way I want to handle the Kynan series going forward and in conjunction with any other content that I'll be putting out. So I am currently working on a new series, on a series of Ironsworn, but a very different kind of series of Ironsworn. For one, I will blend it with another game to tell the story of a settlement, of an isolated homestead. It's also my working title for the series, Homestead. And I have in my hands a preview copy of a game called Stonetop. And by preview copy, I mean like literally a printout of a PDF that they kindly offered to the Kickstarter backers, and I will receive the physical copy presently. Once it's done, I think it'll be probably somewhere next year, because yeah, it's hard finishing stuff in the current climate, what with printing and shipping and lockdowns and all the fun stuff. But I want to use Stonetop, which is also powered by the Apocalypse game, to kind of drive the settlement part, to reflect the passing of the seasons, more detailed challenges that a Iron Age settlement might be facing, to go and staff the NPC roster with the archetypes that are defined in here. So basically use the Stonetop systems to give us a bit of a deeper insight into the village dynamics, and to use the Ironsworn systems to manage the protagonist, the main character of the series, which I don't have any idea of who that's going to be yet. The series is going to be very focused on a specific locale and a specific recurring set of characters, because one takeaway for Ironsworn for me so far that really rather surprised me, to be honest, was the dynamic NPC interaction and how social interactions work that pretty much blindsided me a little bit in the previous chapter of Kynan's story so far. So I want to dig deeper into that. I would like to have a more fleshed out cast to bounce off of with our main character. I also would like to give them more of a face, more of a presence on screen. I would like to have the village as well be its own character, the homestead have a sort of a personality of its own. So we're gonna see probably within the next 2 to 3 months some videos coming up regarding character building, world building, an introduction to what takeaways from these rules I grabbed and wanna fill into the Ironsworn flow of play. And then I'll also, once we have the characters established, I would like to have them commissioned by an artist out there and make sure that we have a little bit more going on screen when there's dialogue. So I like to really have front and center also the character speaking as I do my best to give them a voice. And what that means is drawings for different emotional states, perhaps even a few postures, and then also filling up the roster of people as more and more of them appear. I want to have pretty detailed drawings of the village, pretty detailed map of the village and the surrounding area. So basically taking it one level of detail further and making the visual representation of that series a bit more standout. And the way I'm imagining this interaction is that I want to run one more chapter of Kynan's story. I do know that I want to put the Kynan series on hiatus for a couple of weeks after the next chapter ends, just to give new subscribers a chance to catch up with the, at that point, hours and hours of story that will need to be absorbed somehow so you can actually engage with the new uploads. So I would say expect something in line with Homestead towards the end of the year. Expect the series to kick off somewhere in early 2022, and then we'll see how it goes from there, whether it kicks off on its own separate time slot or whether we take turns with the Kynan series. There's options. Another new series of sorts you might have already noticed. Yesterday I uploaded a video about Twilight 2000, sort of a mix between an unboxing video and a look at the contents, and then also a little bit of a first dive through the rule books. I'm expecting there to be more stuff arriving in the mail intermittently, so every now and again I'll be making another one of these videos, especially since I backed a lot of Kickstarters like a year and a half, 2 years ago, and they're all now slowly chugging along. One Ring is one that I'm very much looking forward to, especially because we have at some point also a solo supplement that will be written by Sean Tomkin of Ironsworn fame and Matt Click of his own various engagements in the RPG scene and his own involvement in Delve. So I'm really rather excited for that Strider mode in One Ring. When it comes out, I'll very, very likely be making something with it for the channel, but that's a ways off. I'm pretty sure that Sean's got his hands full at the moment. There's a lot of deliverables, and whenever it's ready, whenever it's done, that's fast enough for me, to be honest. And finally, at last, chapter one discussion, Kynan's story, off to a weird start, I would say, because my expectation before recording the first session was that I would, within the first session or two, reach a milestone for the background and inciting incident vow that I had in my head sort of marked as consolidating your position. So after a shipwreck, to find a settlement, resupply, and then be in a good position to set out and head on north to pursue this Kalidas angle and this Siora angle. As reality would have it, that isn't quite what happened. And we got another roughly 10, 11 episodes that were story arc very much its own, and that also found a fairly closed off conclusion with some surprising and unintended side effects that now Kynan seems to have adopted a somewhat unlikely traveling companion. So that was quite a curveball the dice threw at me there, and the game sort of also somewhat refused to let me back out of. Like, I couldn't really, after a certain point, after like some point in the second episode, there wasn't really much of a way where I could see Kynan just sneaking off like a thief in the night. And in the end, that for me hit home one of the things that I jotted down as my next point. So the expectation versus reality being subverted almost to a point where you probably, even though it's human to kind of think of, okay, where would the story go from here before you play it, you very likely should just let go of any kind of expectation for the next Ironsworn session, because very likely something better is going to happen than you are able to picture. And my next point would be, my next observation would be that there is a fairly general statement I run into in discussion forums when it comes to solo role playing, that it's like writing a book with dice. And while I get the sentiment behind it, that it's, you get a bunch of writing prompts and you see what you do with them, from my personal experience as somebody who just played that first chapter fully committed to telling a coherent story, it felt more like reading a book. Honestly, I felt more like I was hanging on and trying to guess at what would happen next and then being surprised that that didn't happen and not really seeing a lot of the things coming that were thrown my way as parts of the writing prompts, but it didn't feel like I was in control of the story or in control of the story to the extent that a writer generally is. I also know in the writing process you surprise yourself and you get blindsided by developments and the characters take on a life of their own, but Ironsworn for me is still a step above when it comes to taking the agency of the story onto its own side and letting you be not only the person that fleshes out the steps that the game throws at you, but you're also you're kind of put in the position of the number one fan of your own narrative, almost, where you're also catching yourself sitting there wondering, oh, what is this person going to do next and why is this person doing this, because, you know, you have about the same insight into the story as a reader has that isn't being fed by an omniscient narrator, or at least not receiving an explanation for everything that's happening right as it happens. There is just a lot of moments where I'm finding myself engaging with the story much more from an outsider perspective, looking at it and go like, I wonder why they did that. I wonder what is going to happen next. So I'm, you know, maybe it's semantics or whatever you want to call it, but I'm not really recognizing the writing the book aspect as much as I am finding myself more on the consuming side of things and also having a good time just being surprised by the twists and turns and that moment where you connect two unrelated previous story points because the game kind of forces you to do that and you come up with some explanation and it's like, oh, that's actually pretty cool. I wouldn't ever have written it this way in advance, but now in hindsight, it kind of makes sense and it lets me tell a story that is out of the boundaries that I would probably set for myself and resort to if I would just always follow the first thought that I have and write that out. So that's a very rewarding aspect of playing this game for me. One other observation is regarding the very bare bones world building that Ironsworn comes with and lets you get away with. It's very liberating, and the broad strokes can also be as evocative as like a really fine level of detail in advance, mapping everything out. But having to fill in the gaps in these short intense bursts when all of a sudden you need to explain an element of history of a place because you're in a delve site and you're running into some kind of setup and the prompts give you something and you need to kind of work that into your own world building of your version of the Ironlands and have it become a cohesive whole, that's actually somewhat intimidating. Like, it feels like every decision can mess up your entire setting somehow and just alter the tone of your world in a direction where it's sort of running away from what you actually want it to be. So that was probably also why it took me so long to record some of these episodes, because I was really taking fairly extensive breaks in between die rolls and working through the prompts to cover all the various angles of what I've so far explored about the setting and the world, just to make sure I don't produce a whole bunch of glaring plot holes or contradictions or something, which is also fun. Like, the aspect of retroactive world building and filling in gaps to make sure that your narrative is driven by enough lore and meat on the bone, that's fun to do. It's just intimidating to some extent. And the only real coping mechanism I've found is doing it more and more and more, and then learning to trust yourself that no matter where the narrative takes you, you're probably gonna able to introduce another element at some point that is gonna tie it all together. I mean, at least that's the hope. There is like, let's say there is a catalog of evidence in shows like Lost or Game of Thrones and stuff like that, that this approach doesn't always work. But with Ironsworn, I think the fact that you can bring the world into focus bit by bit and then tie these bits together behind the scene is definitely a less challenging setup as having to work through a whole convoluted, unplanned canon of story and then trying to bind that together somehow. So the fact that it's somewhat sequential in how you reveal things to yourself, really, because you don't know in advance. Like, you just come up with, oh, history, old worlders, what do they sound like? What language? What would their architecture look like? And how does that, you know, all these questions. Being able to do that on a smaller scale, and then if you run into more of it, to extrapolate from that and make it into more like a thematic thing, it does make it a little bit easier. Since the world building and the story are, well, there is an interplay, but it's to some extent up to me how much of the background or how much of the behind the lore explanations I actually want to dive into. I might just have Kynan run into ruins that to him don't make sense and never really explain it because he has no way of finding out what the truth is and just be perfectly content with that. It's just not really how I want to play this. I really want to dig into the world a bit deeper, and I want to discover the things behind the scenes and what is going on in the world and why are these things the way they are. But it's got its tough moments. Speaking of which, role-playing Kynan, that was actually challenging at first, because Kynan also came to be in a way that I don't usually create a character. I sort of ran with the Ironsworn operating mode of leaving a lot of blanks and rolling a few things and letting you kind of letting the reins go and just seeing where it takes me. And usually when I create a character, I go with a fairly rigid character concept that's fairly fleshed out, and I usually give the character a voice, like a way of speaking, an accent, before I even go into the first play session. And with Kynan, I did none of that. I gave him the name and the rough background, and I came up with the shipwreck and the vengeance vow of having to travel all the way through the whole Ironlands as its motivating engine. And I gave him Siora as kind of a companion to bounce off of and occasionally have some interactions with, because otherwise, if he's traipsing through the wilderness, well, it's nice to have a conversation in the session every now and again and do a bit of character building and reflecting that way. But I didn't have details or anything more than that, really. And it took me until around episode 3 to get comfortable and more comfortable with the character. And a lot of the level of slipping into the character came from interacting with the NPCs that the game forced me into creating. So having these moments with Bastion, Saskia, Pierce, Shona, Trim, that was by reflection back on Kynan and having to think about how would he approach the conversation, that gave me a lens to see the character and develop the speech pattern a bit more and kind of slipping into Kynan as a role player, which I don't know if that showed at all in the first episode or two, and I think maybe a lot of that was also just not being used to being in front of a camera or recording anything at all. That was pretty much a first for me. But I feel like the first two, if I watch them back and Kynan is forced to open his mouth or I have to explore things from his perspective, I'm struggling a bit. And not even in a bad way, it's just I'm working my way into who is this going to be. I'm kind of letting Kynan introduce himself to me instead of drafting him up and pretty much telling myself, okay, this is the role you're playing now. That was another new approach for me. So a lot of firsts overall in all of this. One other noticeable thing in hindsight, looking back at the story as it unfolded, how many times the story could have taken a different turn without Kynan deciding that it would. So even though Kynan himself was sort of committed to the Stone Ridge arc after probably the decision through Ziora to not sneak away in the night. There could have been all sorts of factors that would have kept it short. The main driver behind a lot of these events that happened were somewhat bizarre dice rolls, where in key moments then we have negative matches or we have plot twist complications. So it even goes back to all the way with, like, what if Kynan doesn't have a complication and those scavengers don't show up and he decides to kill him, then he makes it to Stoneridge and he will be able to consolidate his position, resupplying, sojourning, and then setting off with the villagers or on his own within the first two episodes. What if Kynan and Bastion end the scene challenge successfully and don't roll a plot twist and beat back the attacking raiders in the night? Likely the next morning the villagers are setting out on their trading journey and he's got his escort there and we're four episodes in and we're off on our merry way. Like, what if Bastion doesn't do a completely insane thing and refuses to hand Kynan over to the raiders, which I think that was the role that, while Bastion's actions make sense within the confines of his Northlander honor concept and, you know, him being a transplanted Nord from Skyrim, effectively, it was still a big what if. Like, what if the villagers hand Kynan over to the raiders? Do we still get the Delf? Possibly. I might have also run into the same situation of asking myself, well, what does Saskia actually want from him? Does she just want to kill him or recruit him? Or what does she want? So we might have still have gotten that. But these moments were very striking to me in hindsight, that there were these forks in the road so many times that could have completely changed the story you've gotten and completely taken away this redemption arc with Etana, this whole Shona situation of her taking more and more shape the more the story went on and turning into turning from faceless dual enemy into fairly likable tragic hero material. And I think that's my main takeaway as well, that the game, if you let it, and if you don't go in with preconceived notions and try to bend the oracles into that direction, it can take you places and introduce you to people that you wouldn't come up with if you just put your pen to paper and write a story without having the oracles there to challenge your vision and give you different lenses to look at your narrative, really, and give you different ideas on where to take your narrative. And generally then the outcome is that you look at the story as it plays out and go like, wow, how'd that happen? So overall I'm really, really satisfied with how this first chapter defied expectations I went in with and also taught me to just let go of my expectations to some extent. So I'm gonna finish setting all of this up now and maybe, I don't know, call an exorcist for the dice, and then I'm gonna start recording. So thanks very much for bearing with me. Thanks very much for watching. I'll catch you next time, and bye for now.